conférence qui s'est tenue novembre 1967.
I'm Prof. Hassan Kafi, AAU governing board member, representing for East African region. Also, I am the president of Plasma University, Mogadishu, Somalia. We really like to give a call for universities in Africa, especially in East Africa, those which are not members still in the Association of African Universities. We are calling them because we feel the organization is ours. It represents the voice of higher education in Africa being seen all over the world.
I am your host, Rita Kusi. 30 Minutes with HR is a partnership program between KUSI Consulting and the Association of African Universities. I would like to acknowledge our sponsors, AH Hotel. We are actually here at the Executive Lounge at the AH Hotel. I would also like to acknowledge Adansi Travels. They have been very, very helpful in getting us to our shoot. And last but not least, I want to acknowledge Nationwide Medical Insurance. Be sure to give them a call for all of your healthcare insurance needs. Today, we are discussing the toll of redundancy on HR and employees. And when we come back, I will introduce you to our guests.
Welcome to Adansi Travels Product Knowledge Series. And I'm excited to talk to you about our FIT toll service, where you get the opportunity to customize the products to your taste. And with that, we take your details, your destination you want to go, the date you want to travel. We're able to do it to suit your budget. So you don't need to worry about breaking the bank when you are traveling with this kind of service. You can visit us as the details are on the screen, as you see, or you can call us on the numbers showing on the screen. Let's plan your trip for you. And you know, with Adansi, we always let you feel the beauty of life.
Adansi Travel feels life's beauty.
Hello, welcome back to 30 Minutes with HR, your premier human resource show for employers, employees, HR professionals, job seekers. Basically, anyone can watch this show and gain insights from it. Today, we are discussing the toll of redundancy on employers, employees, and also HR. And I am joined by Senyo M. Ejaben. Senyo is an author. He is a human resource and labor specialist, and he's also the founder of CAS LLC, which is a labor and dispute resolution firm.
Yes.
Okay, so welcome.
Thank you.
It's actually not your first time on this show. This is your second time, right?
Yes, this is the second time.
You were with us
last year. I was on the show.
Wow, so welcome back.
Thank you.
New set, how does it feel to...
It feels great. It feels like home.
Excellent. Yes. Does it really? So I'm always excited talking to Senyo. He has a great sense of humor. But today's discussion is not a funny one at all. We are talking redundancy, which is a reduction in workforce. Another term for redundancy is layoff, yes, which is involuntary termination,
yes,
right?
Yes.
So I'll have you actually get into the definition of redundancy.
So just as you've said, Rita, redundancy is basically a reduction of force, and it's a process where during the amalgamation, that is the joining of two companies, or during the restructuring of companies, or during the closure of companies, workers lose their jobs. And so if the restructuring results in the loss of jobs, then we say that the workers have become redundant, and so the redundancy process must be followed. So generally, that would be the general definition of what a redundancy process is.
Okay, thank you for that. So I think we don't talk about the issue of redundancy enough in this country, especially within the past year. I'm sure you are aware of the changes, the drastic changes that have been made in the finance sector, with all the the closing down of some of the banks and also the savings and loans, microfinance companies, which obviously if all those companies close down, it means that a lot of people are losing their jobs.
Yes.
Yeah, so can we talk a bit about that?
Sure. So in mergers and acquisitions, okay, or in the liquidation of companies, one of the major issues that come up is either the integration of workers into the new entity, if it's a merger, or the redundancy or the exit of workers or talent that would not be needed by the new entity. Of course, if a company is closing down, then it means that the workers would have to be exited. So the restructuring of the reforms in the financial sector has resulted in a lot of job losses. And this, even though it's normal, is difficult, especially because it's quite difficult to find jobs these days. And so when people have to lose their jobs, it brings about a lot of social and financial issues. But having said that, it is also important that when workers have to lose their jobs under the processes of redundancy, the legal procedures are followed so that their rights are fully enforced.
Okay.
And so that they do not walk away having been shortchanged, but their rights will be asserted and they would know that, yes, this is not necessarily targeted at them, but it's part of the process. And so under the circumstances, they walk away from the redundancy table with something they can use to reestablish themselves, etc., etc.
Okay. I think, you know, with redundancies, I don't believe a lot of employers are honest, especially with mergers and acquisitions, right? When the company's being taken over, they do provide some false hope to employees and have them think that they may be moving forward with the organization. But let's be honest, I think everyone pretty much has their own agenda,
yes,
right, when it comes to business. When a company is being taken over, the chances of them bringing in their own people and laying off the staff of the older company, I think, is very high.
Yes.
Right? So that actually leads to a lot of people losing their jobs.
Exactly so. So this is a very important issue you've raised, because normally in mergers acquisitions or in the restructuring of companies, one of the communication strategy would be to first assure everybody that no employee is going to lose their jobs. Now, technically, that is not quite often the case, because when you merge two entities, the new entity would have a new identity, and that new identity may not need all the talent that the old entities had. So under the circumstances, even if there's a merger or acquisition and the workers are assured that nobody will lose their job, that would be in the interim. But going forward, say between 12 to 24 months, there would definitely have to be a reduction in force to ensure that the new entity takes on the design and structure that it is set up for.
Okay.
Yeah, so it is always important for employees to know that once there is the announcement of a merger or acquisition, or of course if it's a liquidation, that one everybody knows they are
exactly
going home. But if there's any form of restructuring, workers need to psychologically, you know, be prepared that possibly they may be losing their jobs, so that they can start, you know, planning and preparing the next line of their actions, you know, more strategically than to wait and sit and hope and then to be hit with the news within 24 hours that you will no longer be part of us. And that takes a toll on a lot of workers.
And I believe planning starts at the very beginning, right, upon entry, because let's be honest, no employment is permanent.
Yeah.
Most employment is at will. The employer can lay you off, you know, regardless of whatever reason. However, what are some measures that an employee, when you're applying for a position, what can you do to maybe cover yourself in the case of redundancies? Are there certain questions you can ask? Is there certain clause that you should look for in the employee manual and your offer letter? How do they protect themselves at the very early
good stage? So let's walk through the redundancy process. And I always tell prospective employees and also the employed, those who are in employment, that once you walk into the door of an organization, you have to know that at some point you're going to walk out, even if it is upon retirement. And so the exit from an organization is something that every employee should look out for and also prepare for. So what happens during a redundancy, in accordance with the labor law, is that first of all, any employer who contemplates restructuring or amalgamation or even liquidating or insolvency, where workers are most likely to lose their jobs, would have to give to the chief labor officer 3 months notice in writing prior to the date of the effective date of the exercise.
Wow.
If there's a union, the law also says that the union should be given same notice.
Okay.
The law doesn't mention employees specifically, but on the ground, if there's no union, employees are supposed to be communicated with or information shared with employees. So the law allows that then if there's no union, employees as a group or the group of people who be affected or the entire workforce should be updated on the going-ons of the company, which probably may lead to the loss of jobs and redundancy. So there's a 3 months window, which is really important. Let me explain this a bit because it's
please
important.
Please do.
Normally, a lot of practitioners think that the 3 month notice for redundancy is actually a termination notice. It's not. It's a consultative notice. It's a notice that says that in 3 months this might happen, so let's start talking. So the clauses, the termination clauses in the contract of employment still exist and still is enforceable under the circumstances of redundancy. That's the first one. Good. So beyond that, then within the consultative notice period, the employer is supposed to share information on possibly the number of positions and jobs that are going to be affected, the number of workers that are going to be affected in the various classes, from which departments. Information they also have to share is what led to their decision, to lay off workers or to restructure, and what the impact would be on the various employees. And then most importantly, what a lot of people do not normally bring their minds to bear on is the issue of the fact that the law requires the employer to assist the workers who would be impacted to mitigate the impact of the redundancy exercise. For example, by giving them training to be able to be abreast with new employable skills and those other trainings, and then also to take them through processes that helps them to deal with the job loss psychologically and emotionally, and then also possibly to help the employees reach out to other similar organizations in industry to employ them, so that where another organization may be looking for that kind of talent that is being lost, then the employer can reach out to those organizations to help the employees to get new jobs.
Wow.
But these aspects of the law often are not enforced, they are not applied accordingly, but that is why these discussions are good,
exactly.
And they have to be going on, so that someone must try and help enforce those aspects of the law.
Wow.
Okay, so beyond the consultative period is also the issue of negotiation. the law requires that the redundancy pay or severance pay is compensation that should be paid to the worker that loses the job during a redundancy exercise. And this severance pay is negotiable. In other jurisdictions, their laws prescribe specifically what amount of money or how much money as compensation should be paid to a redundant worker. Our law does not do that. Our law leaves the door open for negotiation, and there's a reason for that. During redundancies, all organizations are not the same in terms of their financial capacity. So they negotiate on all those number of factors, okay, so that they can come to a conclusion that best fits and is custom to the situation, okay, the reality
on
the ground.
Which I think is fair, right? Because it is again, fair. Not every organization has the same amount of resources.
Exactly.
Yeah.
But the problem that creates is the issue of disagreement. Once an employee is losing their job, they are hurt and they are emotionally very charged. So often they are not rational in terms of their emotional stability. So they tend to be difficult negotiators under those circumstances. The employer also would be battling with issues of finances, because if the finances of the company was good, everything was okay, then restructuring would not be necessary, or redundancy or insolvency or liquidation and okay, all of those things would not be necessary. So then it becomes a tag.
It's very tough.
Yeah, and so the law says that negotiate. However, the window of opportunity is provided by the law, where it says where the parties are not able to agree, then they have to turn to the National Labor Commission to help them use ADR processes like mediation, arbitration, and also facilitation to help the parties to agree on a specific redundancy package.
Okay.
But not every employee that goes through a redundancy process is entitled to a
okay,
package.
I was going to ask you that.
The law says that where an employee suffers diminution, that means that, for example, if there's a measure and the employee's pay and allowances and benefits are all the same, the employee does not suffer any losses
okay,
in their old pay. Okay. So under those circumstances, they are not entitled to any compensation. It is only when they suffer a loss of the job or if they're moving into another job within the restructuring process or another job position,
okay,
and they lose any of the benefits, then that is liable to an entitlement to the redundancy pay, which is the compensation for the loss of those benefits or the job.
Okay. That was a lot of information you just shared. That was loaded, so thank you very much. I just want to bring it back to the negotiation process. I believe a lot in setting HR policies, right? Especially at the onset of any organization. I just did a workshop a couple of days ago on that. So with regards to negotiations, is that something the employer can do at the very, just to avoid conflict, can they do that at the very beginning when they are hiring an employee? Can they set that policy in place so that the employee knows from early on that, you know what, if I am to be laid off, this is the package that I would be presented, so that it doesn't become, you know, an issue of conflict later on?
Yes, there's there are two schools of thought on that, and there's been a lot of debate since 2005 when the law was it was passed in 2003, but because the National Labor Commission was established in 2005, that is when we started really seeing the law in action. So a lot of debate has been around this. The first school of thought is that why don't you predetermine the rate, the rate of pay of the redundancy,
okay,
so that by the time of redundancy, at least everybody knows what
exactly
is going to, you avoid
you would
all
have even
the,
prepared and planned and put the money aside just in case.
Exactly.
Right?
Then the second school of thought is that, well, when the redundancy hits, because nobody can really predict the future, you may find it difficult to pay what you have predetermined. And then what happens? It creates more disputes. So it is just good that per the law, when the time comes, you negotiate. I am more in tune to the first approach, where the whole package is predetermined.
Exactly.
If it is predetermined, normally would advise employers that then they can, in their financials, provide.
Plan for it.
They can provide for it so that they always have a fund available for such purposes that they can use for. Now, under those circumstances, it is very easy to establish. You know, organizations that do well are organizations that plan. So to handle redundancy processes, it's all in the planning. When we establish an organization, we know that when employees come, because times change and situations change and the environment changes in terms of business environment, redundancies are inevitable. They are basically a part of every life cycle of an organization. So it is important that organizational leaders plan for these redundancies so that when they occur, they can easily step up to it and then handle it more effectively.
Okay. Thank you so much. We will be right back, actually. And I obviously have more questions. You know, this is a topic that I feel needs to be discussed often, especially because of the times that we're in. So we'll be right back with more conversation about redundancy and the toll it has on HR, employers, and employees. So stay tuned.
Check in at the AH Hotel, East Legon, where every stay is unique.
Everybody wants to be the best at what they do for the people they're doing it for. That's why, after 13 years of providing you with top-notch healthcare nationwide, the market leader in the private health insurance industry is going the extra mile for you. Instead of hopping from pharmacy to pharmacy, now you get your prescription drugs delivered straight to your doorstep. We will restock your chronic medication on the regular so you don't have to stress to keep track. We provide on-site clinics that offers you professional medical consultation from the comfort of your office. Enjoy these amazing benefits and so much more by signing on to Nationwide Medical Insurance today. Call us on 0800-222-222 or email us at info@nationwidemh.com. Nationwide, we go the extra mile so you don't have to. Join the healthcare family.
Welcome back to 30 Minutes with HR, your premier human resource show for employers, employees, job seekers, and everyone. I believe this is an insightful show for everyone to watch, actually. Again, thank you to our sponsors, AH Hotel. We are here live at the Executive Lounge. Thank you for Adansa Travels for transporting us. And also thank you to Nationwide Medical Insurance. Be sure to give them a call for all of your healthcare medical needs. All right. We are back discussing the toll of redundancy on HR, employers and employees. And I'm joined by Senyo M. Ejabeng. So Senyo, I mean, you were just sharing a lot of insights before we went on break. What I would like to know, and what I'm sure a lot of the people watching would like to know as well, is with the recent changes to the finance sector, with the redundancies that have occurred within the past year, is there something that you think HR could have done? Is there a role that HR could have played to make sure that this didn't occur?
Well, yes, but if it's about stopping stopping or preventing the job losses, I don't think that that would have been possible. But in terms of guiding the organizations to handle the process a lot more effectively, yes, that would be the role of HR in handling of measures and acquisitions and liquidations. The role of HR is key because when you merge two companies, you have to integrate not only the operational aspect of the business, but the people as well. And when it comes to integrating the people, you are integrating their benefits, you are integrating culture, and you're also integrating conduct generally. So under the circumstances, HRM should have a huge role to play in helping the organization to, one, communicate effectively, and also, two, to comply with the dictates of law as required by legal processes or fair procedure. And then, thirdly, to advise on the best way of mitigating the impact of the job losses. So under the circumstance, we can look at the recent financial sector reforms, and I think that communication could have been handled a bit more better, because when communication is not handled well internally, then you find a lot of external communication in the media. That there are a lot of organizations or that a lot of cases where measures and acquisitions have occurred, but there was not that much brouhaha in the media.
Exactly.
So communication of the process to workers and all other stakeholders, action planning or joint action planning, joint consultations, very, very important in these processes. And I think that these are some of the things that HRM can lead and support the organization with whenever such things occur.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for that. You know, I think communication is actually, it's critical, I think, in a lot of instances, especially with HR, engaging employees and being able to communicate effectively with them. One of the toughest things I've ever had to do in my HR career is actually lay off. But not just that, but like I literally had to lay off friends. So in that instance, I mean, can you imagine the sleepless nights, the plan and the thinking, oh my gosh, how am I going to do this? Are we still going to be friends after this? How do I get them to understand my position? We talk a lot about the role of redundancy on employees, which of course is natural because they have the most to lose.
Yeah.
However, let's talk about the toll it takes on HR professionals as well.
So let me sit well.
Please sit well.
This is the crunch of the matter, because a lot of people overlook the toll of such processes on the HRM practitioner. Under the circumstances, an HRM practitioner is normally under double the pressure that both the employee and the employer would be under, because both employees and employers would bring their pressures down to bear on the HR practitioner. So And normally everybody thinks that an HR practitioner is supposed to be okay. Everybody runs to HR with their problems. But who takes care of the HR practitioner? So it's an important aspect of this that you've raised. HR practitioners will often be under pressure from the employees because they are losing their jobs. And I know examples where HR practitioners who normally are the face of the redundancy exercises become a target of some of the employees and sometimes are threatened, including death threats. Wow. And also threats of spiritual harm, etc., etc. Then on the other side, the employer would also be giving HRM pressure to get the process done exactly. with, given timelines and all that, based on which the performance of the HRM person is going to be measured. So what I normally would advise HRM people is that they should not take on the entire responsibility of shouldering and driving the redundancy process. They should always bring on board an expert, consultant, exactly. and a team of advisors to partner with the organization and help them go through the process. Under those circumstances, these consultants and experts would normally soak in some of the pressure for which would have been taken by the HRM person. So it is not only about maybe losing money or paying expert advice for or paying experts or advisors for such processes, but it's also a strategy to make sure that after the process, everything goes on smoothly, the organization returns back to normal, and also is re-engineered to be able to perform as though nothing happened. But when this is not done, there are a lot of insecurities that become the residue of the process, and then that becomes an Achilles heel that may mitigate against the performance of the organization and also the internal relationships. You know, in mergers and acquisition, in redundancy processes, the aftermath of the process and how the organization copes is important. And most especially, how the security or the insecurities of the, let me put it this way, the mitigation of the insecurities of the workers who remain.
Okay.
For them to exactly. be able to exactly. now be loyal and fully engaged to continue
exactly.
with their work, and therefore driving performance in the organization is very important. Because if that does not happen, and through the process, there are a lot of antagonism and fights and disputes, and those are not resolved properly, then going forward, the organization starts to limp instead of running.
I love that you brought that up, right? Because it's not just, when we talk about employees being affected, it's not just the employees who are facing redundancy that are being affected,
yes.
the co-workers as well.
Yeah, exactly.
So how do you manage that relationship? You know, yeah, you lose hope, you become nervous, you become fearful of your job.
Jobs, right? job security exactly. becomes a problem.
And it also takes a toll on the employer as well, because if people are feeling this way, you better believe they're probably looking for a way out of your organization.
Aha.
You know, so yeah. that affects turnover as well.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting. So I think we've literally hit on so many points in this conversation, and what I'm gathering from it all is that everyone has a role to play when it comes to redundancy, right? Obviously, you, the employee, I always tell employees, make sure you read the fine print, get your employee manual. If you have any questions, ask questions,
yes.
right? Because you have to also know how to protect yourself from facing any redundancy.
Exactly.
Right? So ask these questions, have these conversations even before you start. And obviously, HR has to make sure that they are keeping up to brush with the laws mm-hmm. and the rules, and mm-hmm. they are having these conversations. They are literally planning ahead. The organization also has to be planning ahead
yes.
in case anything happens, because anything can happen.
Sure.
You know, I'm sure the companies that were closed down last year and this year alone, they probably didn't see it coming, and it happened. So how do you plan? How do you make sure that you are ready? And is there even a right way to even to lay people off?
Well, yes, there's certainly a right way and a wrong way. But for the employee, every employee needs, like I said at the beginning, every employee needs to know that once they walk in, there's a possibility of walking out.
Exactly.
So if you ask me, I would say that every employee should make sure that they have a primary job and a secondary job and possibly a tertiary job. So they spread their skills around and make sure that when they lose their primary source of income, they can have some temporary, you know, forms of income to lay on before looking for maybe other major jobs and you know. So there must be a backup for employment under all circumstances while an employee is engaged with an employer, because anything can happen.
Exactly.
For the employers, it's basically about making sure that they are compliant. We have the best advice available.
Okay.
They do not go through the process without advice,
exactly.
Legal advice,
exactly.
Technical advice, and then they also make sure that they are financially prepared
exactly.
at all times.
Exactly.
So now redundancy is something that organizations should provide for. Once they do that, the stress of financing the process is reduced, because redundancy is an expensive process, especially in terms of the payment of the packages
of
and so on. And for the HR practitioner, it's important to be abreast with the contemporary issues that continue to come up regarding this area of practice. So they have to be abreast with case law, that is the pronouncement of the courts on disputes regarding these. They have to be abreast with the areas of the law that we are talking about, through to how disputes are resolved when redundancy exercises are done, as well as generally being on top of what should be done and leading the organization to go through the process without any hitches and as smoothly as possible, managing the communication process with the workers and so on.
Okay.
So is there a bad way of doing it? Yes. And oftentimes when I do a detailed study on specific redundancy exercises that I've done, the bottom line often would be a gap in the communication. So the workers normally are not well informed, and because of that, a lot of rumors come up, and then the process becomes difficult.
Exactly.
Then also, when the workers are agitated, how they are engaged is also another level of communication skills that HR people must show. So for me, communication is key, as we have said. Then the wrong way of doing it is not following the law,
okay.
and not following due process. Under those circumstances, you find that the employees most definitely will come to practitioners like us, consultants, who would then file complaints on behalf of the workers, or the workers will find themselves to court or the Labour Commission themselves, and then the whole process now starts becoming very murky.
Okay.
So there's definitely wrong ways of doing it, but the best is to make sure that we are compliant and we have the necessary advice.
Excellent. And you mentioned something that also struck me, you know, and that is establishing partnerships or relationships with other business entities.
Yes.
Because when you have to lay people off, but you must accommodate them and make sure that they find employment,
yes.
who will you turn to?
Yes.
You know, so I think businesses, rather than looking at those within our sector as competitors all the time, maybe we should look to them as hey, partners, let's establish some just in case, you know, if things don't work out for my business and I have to close down or lay employees off, at least I can give, you know, my, my colleagues.
And also another very, very helpful pool of stakeholders are suppliers of, of the business.
Yes.
So if you have very good suppliers, you can roll over one or two workers to these suppliers so that at least you mitigate the numbers a bit. So that if maybe it's 1,000 people going home, if you can do about 50 or 60% of those kind of mitigation, that would be perfect.
And I think especially for HR, it's very important, right, to establish relationships with other HR professionals.
Exactly.
They are the ones that do the hiring, right? So this is definitely a message to HR. Be sure to establish partnerships with other HR professionals to help you, you know, through that process. But this has been a very good conversation, and I just felt it was so needed. We needed to talk about this. We needed to have this discussion and provide this insight, you know, not just for employees, but for employers and also for HR professionals.
How and policymakers.
And policymakers as well, exactly. Mm-hmm. You know, we need to, I think, start thinking. Times have changed.
Mm-hmm.
Things are changing. So how do we keep up with our policies? But I do hope there's a change where maybe employers will have the option to put in place any redundancy clause or policies ahead of time before hiring the employees to kind of help them so that it doesn't become an issue. Because I think it becomes more of an issue at the end because everybody's so tense, there's so much pressure, and now you want to start negotiating redundancy pay. I don't think that's the best idea, but that's a different conversation.
Yeah.
So now, here's a bit of the fun part. I know you're usually Mr. Friendly. You are like, you know, in our HR group, you're a superstar. You're a superstar in HR. You know
really?
That, right?
I didn't know that.
Well, now you know. Now you know. And I would like to share with our viewers that Senyo has actually published a book. So can you tell us where we can get copies, and can you tell us a bit about what the book is about?
So the book is titled Career Toolkit for Successful Job Hunting. I think that it's a very good book, not because I wrote it, but because of the content. It handles it handles job search from a different point of view, where you have information on how to actually plan and search for the job, how to prepare and get the job in terms of interviews and all that. And after you are done, I think it's one of the books that would tell you what should go into a contract of employment and what you should expect from a contract of employment and how you can negotiate a contract of employment. So that is basically the scope of the book. And it's currently at Legon Bookshop and also Vide Bookstore in Osu.
Nice.
Yes.
Nice. Thank you. I hope you go and pick up your copy of this book, because he is an HR expert. So if you get this book, I'm sure it'll be able to really help you with all of your HR needs, getting that job especially. All right. Is there anything else that you would like to share with the viewers? Where can they find you? Maybe other services that you offer that they can tap into?
Basically, mergers and acquisitions is, and especially the HR component, the employee relations component of mergers and acquisitions, is one of the things I do very well. It's one of my niche areas.
Yeah.
So yes, if anybody needs information, further information on mergers and acquisitions, they can always go online. Just Google my name, Senyo M. Ajabeng, and a lot of my contacts and everything would. I'm very, very easy to find online, and so they can always contact me online, and I'll be available to offer them any advice and also guidance that that they need.
And you're also always very willing and just so helpful. You know, I think in the HR space, you're just that go-to guy. I think we're even planning a session with you,
registering
services, where you're going to be teaching us.
Yes, that's pro bono. I practice HRM with passion.
Okay.
I find that it's an area of our lives. We all work We spend more hours working than doing anything else. We spend more work in the workplace. And so if the workplace is not friendly and the workplace has too many problems, then our lives become problematic. Exactly. And we are not healthy. And also we're not able to fully achieve our capabilities and our usefulness of our talents and gifts. So it's a passionate thing for me to be able to share knowledge and advice and build the capacity of people in this area of practice that seems to have a lot of problems in our part of the world.
Exactly.
Yes.
Well, it definitely comes across that way. So thank you very much for accepting to even come on again a second time. So now the third time we have to have Senyo back, right? You're just quite knowledgeable, so I really do appreciate having you on the show.
Thank you.
And I'm sure everyone watching appreciates having you on as well. So,
thank you.
Thank you for joining us for another episode of 30 Minutes with HR. Again, thank you to our sponsors, AH Hotel, Nationwide Medical Insurance, and Adansi Travels. We will see you next week.
Hello, you are watching Events Updates on AAU TV, the voice of higher education in Africa. Events Updates brings you information about upcoming higher education events happening in Africa, and it is brought to you by the Association of African Universities. I am Isabella Tetahinakwa.
Je m'appelle Alexandra Mpaba Johnson.
Please stay tuned. Welcome back. The Association of African Universities and the Lower Open University College is organizing the 6th General Assembly and Conference on the African Council for Distance Education on the theme Open and Distance Learning, the Continental Education Strategy for Africa and the Sustainable Development Goal 4. Date, 24th to 27th March 2020. Venue, Association of African University Secretariat, Accra, Ghana. Expected participants are leaders and managers of higher education institutions, scholars, policymakers, professionals, students, development agencies, and other stakeholders. Please visit www.aau.org or www.lower.edu.gh for more information. You can also email info@lower.edu.gh.
L'Association des universités africaines et Lower Open University College organise la 6e Assemblée générale et conférence du Conseil africain pour l'enseignement à distance sur le thème « Enseignement ouvert et à distance, la stratégie éducative continentale pour l'Afrique et l'objectif de développement durable 4 ». Date 24 au 27 mars 2020, lieu secrétariat de l'Association des universités africaines, Accra, au Ghana. Les participants attendus sont les dirigeants et gestionnaires d'établissements d'enseignement supérieur, chercheurs, décideurs, politiques, professionnels, étudiants, agences de développement et autres parties prenantes. Veuillez visiter www.aau.org ou www.laue.edu.gh pour plus d'informations. Vous pouvez également envoyer un email à info@laue.edu.gh.
The Tongji University is calling for application for 2020 entry, as well as the United Nations Environment Programme, UNEP, and the Tongji Institute of Environment for Sustainable Development, IESD, are offering full and partial scholarships for excellent candidates to pursue master's and doctoral programs. They are offering a two-year master program for the purpose of educating high-end and interdisciplinary talent working in the applied fields of government, trade, foreign affairs, agriculture, technology, education, culture and health, building intellectual capacity and facilitating the economic and social development of the recipient countries. Interested applicants can apply via the link on your screen. You can also visit www.campuschina.org.
Le programme des Nations Unies pour l'environnement et l'Institut Tongji de l'environnement pour le développement durable, IESD en sigle, offre des bourses complètes et partielles aux excellents candidats pour poursuivre des programmes de maîtrise et de doctorat. Ce programme de master est conçu pour encourager les responsables commerciaux et le personnel de direction des pays bénéficiaires. Ils offrent un programme de maîtrise de 2 ans dans le but de former des talents de haut niveau et interdisciplinaires travaillant dans des domaines appliqués du gouvernement, du commerce, des affaires étrangères, de l'agriculture, de la technologie, de l'éducation, de la culture et santé, du renforcement des capacités intellectuelles et faciliter le développement économique et social des pays bénéficiaires. Pour postuler à la bourse, veuillez visiter le lien qui s'affiche sur votre écran.
The Makerere University and the government of Uganda are inviting you to join the international leaders and experts for the 2020 World Health Summit regional meeting to address the biggest challenges in global health in the region and around the world. Date, 27th to 28th April 2020. Venue, Speke Resort and Munyonyo Commonwealth Resort, Kampala, Uganda. Topics to be discussed at the summit are the health of the African youth, advancing technology for health in Africa, global health security, non-communicable diseases, intersectoral action for health, as well as universal health coverage. For more information, please contact Dr. Charles Bate via dr.cbate@gmail.com or call +256 700 800 618. You can also visit www.worldhealthsummit.org.
L'université Makerere et le gouvernement de l'Ouganda vous invitent à rejoindre les dirigeants et experts internationaux pour la réunion régionale du Sommet mondial de la santé 2020 afin de relever les grands défis de la santé mondiale dans la région et dans le monde. Date 27 au 28 avril 2020, lieu Speke Resort et Munyonyo Commonwealth Resort, Kampala, Uganda. Les sujets porteront sur la santé de la jeunesse africaine, comment faire progresser la technologie pour la santé en Afrique, la sécurité sanitaire mondiale, les maladies non transmissibles, l'action intersectorielle pour la santé et la couverture sanitaire universelle. Pour plus d'informations, veuillez contacter le Dr Charles Bate via dr.cbate@gmail.com ou appeler le +256 780 06 18. Vous pouvez également visiter www.worldhealthsummit.org.
The African Center of Excellence for Genomics of Infectious Diseases, ISGID, hosted by the Redeemers University, Nigeria, is recruiting for position of project coordinator. Interested applicants should have university degree in a relevant field, 2 to 3 years of site-level coordination experience required, must have excellent written and verbal communication skills, have the ability to interact with an interdisciplinary group including international collaborators, global health researchers, research scientists, and data analysts, should have experience in global health or genetics desired as well as managing sponsors' relations desired. All cover letters, CVs and any other relevant documents should be sent to info.asgid@rand.edu.ng. And for more information, kindly visit www.asgid.org or call +234 8068 528936.
Le Centre d'excellence africain pour la génomique des maladies infectieuses (EGID) à Redeemers University au Nigeria lance un appel à candidature pour le poste de coordinateur de projet. Le candidat intéressé doit avoir un diplôme universitaire dans un domaine pertinent, 2 à 3 ans d'expérience en coordination au niveau du site requis, doit avoir d'excellentes compétences en communication écrite et verbale, la capacité d'interagir avec un groupe interdisciplinaire comprenant des collaborateurs internationaux, des chercheurs en santé mondiale, des chercheurs scientifiques. Et les analystes de données devraient avoir une expérience en santé mondiale ou en génétique souhaitée, ainsi que la gestion des relations avec des sponsors souhaités. Veuillez envoyer toutes lettres de motivation, CV et autres documents pertinents à info.eschid@juan.edu.ng Et pour plus d'informations, visitez www.sgide.org. Vous pouvez aussi appeler le plus 234 80 68 52 89 36.
The Association of Educational Researchers and Evaluators of Nigeria, ASEREN, is inviting you to the 22nd Annual Conference UMO Decade 2020 on the theme Educational Research and Evaluation in the 21st Century. Date 20th to 24th July 2020. Venue Michael Opara University of Agriculture, UMO Decade, Nigeria. This conference is geared towards improving the quality of education and promoting national development and will provide opportunities for educators, researchers and evaluators within and outside Nigeria to share innovative ideas on the theme. All abstracts should be submitted to akanwa.esla.mouau.edu.ng or odo.collins@mouau.edu.ng before 31st March 2020. And to register, please visit the ASEREN website on www.naera.org.ng or kindly call Michael Akinshola Mitibemu on +234 7058 539 888 for more information.
L'Association des chercheurs et évaluateurs en éducation du Nigeria, ASEREN, vous invite à la 22e conférence annuelle nommée UMO Decade 2020 sur le thème Recherche et évaluation en éducation au 21e siècle. Date 20 au 24 juillet 2020, lieu Université d'agriculture Michel Opara, UMO Decade, Nigeria. Cette conférence vise à améliorer la qualité de l'éducation et à promouvoir le développement national et offrira aux éducateurs, chercheurs et évaluateurs au Nigeria et à l'extérieur des opportunités de partager des idées innovantes sur le thème. Tous les résumés doivent être soumis à akanwa.ursula@mouau.edu.ng ou odo.collins@mouau.edu.ng avant le 31 mars 2020. Pour vous inscrire, visitez le site web ASEREN sur www.naere.org.ng ou appelez Michel Akinshola Métibemou au +234 70 58 53 98 88 pour plus de détails.
When you think of a university, you think of a place where you will go to cut out your future. And when you get there, you realize there's a lot more to it. The beautiful structures, facilities and ambience. A place where you meet great minds, learn from each other, experience different cultures, as well as master the art of fundamental problem solving. Be part of a whole different study experience with Kampala International University, KIU, exploring the heights.
The Accra Institute of Technology, AIT, is inviting you to the International Research Initiatives Conference, IRIC, which is an annual international research focus conference that serves as an international forum for presenting and discussion of outputs of ongoing cutting-edge research efforts and initiatives of researchers in the universities, research institutions, and industry. Date 19th to 20th August 2020. Venue, KCC Kokomlimli of the Accra Institute of Technology, Accra, Ghana. Subthemes to be discussed are science, technology, and innovation, advancing in computing science, engineering advancement and innovation, educational technology and innovation, agriculture technologies and innovation, and many more. AIT is also calling for papers, and all abstracts should be submitted before 30th April 2020. For more details, kindly visit www.iric.us or contact Prince Darko at pdarko@ait.edu.gh or apme@ait.edu.gh.
L'Institut de technologie d'Accra, AIT, vous invite à sa conférence internationale sur les initiatives de recherche, IRIC, une conférence internationale annuelle axée sur la recherche qui sert de forum international pour présenter et discuter des résultats des efforts de recherche de pointe en cours et les initiatives des chercheurs des universités, des instituts de recherche et de l'industrie. Date 19 au 20 août 2020, lieu KCC Kokomemle de l'Institut de technologie d'Accra, Ghana. Les sous-thèmes à discuter comprennent la science, la technologie et l'innovation STI, le progrès en informatique, l'avancement et l'innovation en ingénierie, la technologie éducative et innovation, les technologies agricoles et innovation, entre autres. AIT lance également un appel à communication et tous les résumés doivent être soumis avant le 30 avril 2020. Pour plus de détails, veuillez visiter www.iric.us ou contacter Prince Darko via pdarko@ait.edu.gh ou apme@ait.edu.gh.
That is all for today's update. Event update is brought to you by the Association of African Universities. Please follow us on our social media platforms at Association of African Universities on Facebook and YouTube, AAU_African Universities on Twitter, and AAU TV Official on Instagram. You can also visit our dedicated website at tv.aau.org for more of events updates. I am Isabella Titahinakwa.
Je m'appelle Alexandra Mpaba Johnson.
Good morning and welcome to today's edition of AAU Talks from the AAU TV, the voice of higher education in Africa. Today we'll be looking at the interactions of national values, concepts, beliefs and cultures in higher education within internationalization. And my name is Freda Awa, your host, and when we come back, I'll be introducing my guest. Thank you.
Kampala International University, you are the torch that guides our path. In you we see a future bright, and by you the nation gained from services to the end, and that you trust is the message you need in great hearts.
Thank you and welcome back to the AAU TV. To discuss the topic today, E. Williams, Ivan. Prof, do you want to tell us a bit about your university?
Yes, thank you for asking. Concordia University Irvine is located in Southern California. We have approximately a little over 4,000 students in our graduate and undergraduate programs. At our university, you can earn bachelor's, master's, MBA, as well as educational doctorate, or EDD. We take pride in having five schools within the university. We have the School of Education, School of Arts and Sciences, School of Business, School of Professional Studies, and School of Theology, or Christ College, which is what we were founded. We are a faith-based university. However, we encourage all students from all walks of life to join us, to come study with us and learn with us. And we are proud to say we have all walks of life there. So those that are faith, as well as those that may not have, that don't have faith, as we say. We have, one of the things that's most important to me is our tagline, and that's more than a tagline, and that's we are committed to developing wise, honorable, and cultivated citizens of the world. And so thank you for asking.
Oh, that's very great. Now, within the context of higher education, What does internationalization mean to you?
Thank you for asking. In order to make, I mean, the world is global, as you know. Internationalization and globalization are twins. And when you're talking about organizations and businesses for when you graduate, making the world a better place, everything is interrelated. So there's no such thing that's just America or just Ghana or just any country, because, you know, just look at you and I. You know, we're, you know, from different walks of life, yet we share a lot of similar goals. So when you talk about higher education, we can no longer, nor should we, look at just one country. It's such an interconnectedness. Internationalization speaks to that. What makes our campus rich is when we have students from other parts, other walks of life, other countries, other cultures, other nationalities, other beliefs, other orientations. That's what makes us great. That's what makes any university like that. So to me, I would start off, Mr. Amwa, with saying that in order for us to create wise, honorable, and cultivated citizens of the world, we must and all should embrace those from outside of the boundaries of certainly my country.
How do you think, from your university's perspective, how have different cultures helped shape internationalization?
You know, that is a very good question. I can answer that question from a couple of perspectives. As you know, I have the privilege to work on our executive team as a vice president, but I'm also in the classroom. I'm a professor, a full professor, as we say. And I mentioned that only to say I have students that I get to touch all the time from different countries, the conversations, the small group discussions. Our students, American students who may not have traveled outside the U.S., they get a chance to learn what's going on. We have a section of our campus called the Global Village, which is where a lot of our international students and domestic students get a chance to exchange. They go to our domestic students, invite international students to their home. Coincidentally, for example, this week is Thanksgiving. You like that? Actually, today is Thanksgiving. It's Thursday, correct? I'm still in the right time zone. And we have a lot of our students that will have invited international students to their home to see. So as we really look at fostering a world, a workplace, a marketplace that is inclusive of everyone, you start in a safe places to talk are in classrooms, whether they're in a K through kindergarten through 12th grade, as we say in the U.S., or at a university level. And I think at the university level, which is higher ed, I mean, we're the linchpin between, you know, the next generations. So
is it the case that you think internationalization is beneficial to the global economy?
Absolutely. The internationalization is not only beneficial, it's essential, I would say. Prior to being at Concordia, and I've been there a little over 19 years, I spent about 20 years in industry, with most of that time in a human resources capacity in our entertainment industry there in Southern California. And I can tell you that today I can remain friends with some of the industry of human resource and hiring professionals, and they look to students, whether they're our graduates, American graduates, or graduates of other countries, what have you done outside of your space? So, you know, being able to say that, you know, we can develop students that have that global perspective, that has actually lived a global perspective, that's what industry is looking for. And the reason why I mention industry is that's the future. Many people go to for higher education, for careers, for jobs, and they'll make the world a better place. You can't just think myopically. You can't think just one place, because it doesn't work. If you and I look at what we have on today, even though you have on cultural attire, and I have on considered Western attire, many more than U.S. hands turn, you know, I've got on my mic, touch this, as well as whether it's the colors, the dyes, the threads, that what you have on, touch more than Ghana. So you can't really have anything today that you can't think that has not had, doesn't have an intercultural, cross-cultural influence.
Well, great. I think I would get a bit more specific on the issue of what globalization offers to African students.
Okay.
In the context of higher education.
Okay.
So in the context of internationalization, mm-hmm. what does it have for students of the African extract?
Okay, thank you for asking. I just, a couple of days ago, I just arrived from Ethiopia, where I spent a few days there, and I've actually have had a trip there before. And we were meeting with some potential doctoral students, and a really something very prophetic came out of that. They have, these are deans at the dean level, you know, very well, I mean, academic, you know, master's level type executives at one of the universities there that are looking to go into our doctorate, our educational doctorate program, because they said to us, you know, in order for us to better Ethiopia, in order for us to better our students, we need to have a leadership, you know, area. We want to expand on research, which is what the doctoral degree gives for you. And so they're really looking at a country that's just coming out of a different type of a democracy, or no democracy actually, and a range of things. So in order for the Ethiopian citizen, the Ethiopian youth, the Ethiopian adulthood to advance, they recognize that they need educational doctors, they need this. And I can only imagine, having spent time in other African countries, that that's true elsewhere. It's true in the U.S., the United States as well. So to specifically address, you know, why I think it's critical for the African university, or the African student, is because Africa is the new Africa. You're the new place where to go. And so, you know, many years ago, we looked to Asia, you know, whether it was China or India or places. Africa is the new, is emerging. I mean, and you, I'm not telling you anything you don't already know. So you need to be prepared. There are things that you can learn from a U.S. system. There are things you can learn from a European system that will make all of us in the world, you know, a much better place. So you can't just look inside Africa just for educational, for internationalization, nor can the U.S. student look just inside the U.S. for education.
Okay, so still on students, from your experience from Concordia University and other jurisdictions that you perhaps have worked within, what are some of the challenges that inhibit the growth and development of students from other jurisdictions in the United States of America, or wherever you've ever worked around?
Cross mobility is huge. And what I mean by that is just getting through the visa system, the immigration system, the cost system, the differences in currencies. These are very real, real questions that began to set the hard parameters for an individual to decide or be able to have access. For example, in the United States as well as in Europe, blended learning and e-learning, you know, online classes is huge. They've now figured out how to make using technology, and so the rigor, the academic rigor, the respect level for these programs are at an all-time high. And if you don't have, you know, something, the band access, if you don't have access of the web and the internet to be able to keep up with that, is a big deteriorate. It's going to be a very big negative. The price, you know, even if universities can do tuition exchanges or something where they can get the tuition piece worked out, which is not always, but just in case, the housing, which are hard copies. Now, I happen to live in Southern California, which has a little higher, you know, housing costs in some places in the United States, but It's and we understand that. So what do you do? What do you do? No university can, no place that I'm aware of, I shouldn't make that as a fact, can say, okay, we're going to open up and come free. You know, come live and study with us free. That's not really what is being asked for, but it's a reality. Then we talked about, briefly I mentioned to you before we met today, about the TOEFL scores, or the IELTS, I think, which is testing that we do for language proficiency. And English language proficiency exams, you know, some people have test anxiety, for example, so they may or may not make the score on the test, yet you can sit down and have conversations or read, and maybe a person would be eligible. So that's a real barrier and a challenge. So once again, just getting into a U.S. institution is from just the immigration issues can be one setback that we wish we could. I wish I had a magic wand and that I could change it.
You mentioned finance as one of the key pertaining to internationalization, especially from countries that are considered not very endowed, going being in today, endowed countries to mm-hmm. study. What opportunities, what funding opportunities mm-hmm. exist for persons who are not able to finance their quest for higher education in other jurisdictions apart from DS?
Mm-hmm. Well, I don't profess to be an expert on this, but I can share with you what I do know, and then, you know, I'd be more than happy to give you some maybe links and some to websites that I'm familiar with and may know. There are certainly, universities give scholarships, no question, you know, like that. They're competitive as well, but universities do that. There are, the United States, for example, also has grants and scholarships available to international students, depending on the area they're going into and what they're doing. So that certainly happens. Then, as I understand it, because I also work closely with Namibia, you know, like that, and Namibia as a country, and having even worked within their president of the country, as well as their ambassadors, and their, they have actual, because education is number one priority, and so they're saying, what can we do? So they have put certain funds around certain areas to help their students, you know, and help their citizens be able to maybe study as it makes sense. So I know opportunities are out there. So I'm hoping that anyone that might be listening or sharing this, don't look at just your own purse and say, well, I can't afford it, so therefore I can't go, and you settle for something. If you have passion about what you want to do, and you know it's going to help the world, not just your country, not just your region, not just Africa, then look for these opportunities, you know, like that, and because they are out there. Like I said, it's competitive, but they are out there.
All right. So I think we've talked a bit more on the concept of internationalization. Mm-hmm. I want us to tie it now more to culture.
Okay.
And the values.
All right.
Of individuals across the world. Mm-hmm. What is it about cultural values, cultural differences, mm-hmm. that makes internationalization worth pursuing?
Okay. So some of the things from a cultural, as you know, my definition of culture as a practicing, you know, communication cultural anthropologist, is culture is beliefs, values, and attitudes, plus behaviors, shared by a group over generations. So in order for something to be considered cultural, it's deep. It's learned, as you know. And things that are learned can be added. It's dynamic. And so just to speak for the moment to make sure I'm understanding culture as you're using the word. So the first thing is, where does education sit within your family?
Okay.
Within my family and within many American families, I certainly wouldn't say all, that would be a stereotype, education is at the top. Education is the way out of whatever areas that if you're in a lower income or lower area for, as a minority, you know, in the United States of America, I was taught that, Cheryl, education is the way for you to better, you know, not only yourself, your family, and your world to do that. And so by all means, education. So when you graduate, that's what you're going to do. So that's one. Where does your culture, where does your family put education in that? Some cultures, having spent some time in India, now it's much better because gender, which is very popular. So now women are being encouraged, you know, to go in not only to college but into advanced degrees. But some areas, and even areas of Africa that I'm studying, women are pretty much go through maybe an eighth grade equivalent, a United States eighth grade equivalent, and not really expanded because women roles, gender roles, defined differently. But it's changing, and I see it's changing, and I'm optimistic that it is. Likewise, what areas do you go in? Men, from a cultural perspective, or maybe have been traditionally, gone more in the sciences and technology, and women have gone more into the arts and sciences or some of the vocations. It is absolutely nothing wrong with that, but we don't want gender to be that definition of what you choose to do. And then some things, so then once you get on campus, here's a cultural difference that I can tell you from a firsthand experience. How assertive, interactive, aggressive might you be with your professor? I have some students that are international as well as American, so it's not just an international student, that will raise their hand, address questions, be in discussion, and they're very interactive. They'll disagree with the professor for the sake of, you know, conversation, which is good. But some won't, because you don't disagree with hierarchy. You know, hierarchy is huge. So you're much more passive in taking copious notes. And as a professor in intercultural international communications, I'm wanting you to engage and get into conversation. That's how I know you're learning. So I have to be mindful as a professor that I can't read one person's behaviors that they're not as good as or as interested in as someone else that might be more willing to speak up. A second one, and then I'll turn it over. It's a tiny bit of a negative, if you like that, but it's a reality, is what is plagiarism? What is cheating? And that's huge. In the United States, as well as in many other, certainly in the Western countries, a lot of them, if you're going to quote something from a book, if you're going to take information from another previously published thing, then you cite it. And we happen to use different styles in the United States. Maybe, perhaps you've heard of the APA or MLA, I'm using initial Chicago style, but you cite it. I've had students that have turned in papers, and I know that they want their words. And so it looks on its face as clear cheating or clear plagiarism. But then I understand, and I actually had this by a student that I was teaching here, that said, no, but once information is out in the free world, how can you say that knowledge is someone's once they've put it out there? So it's not cheating, it's actually, I'm just using what I know and available. They don't have that a negative, deceitful mindset. So that's very different. You know, about being mindful that if you're coming from a culture where that hasn't been something taught to you from early on, and now you land in a U.S. institution, and you not only will flunk a class, but it's grounds for dismissal from a university. And as an international student, if you flunk a semester, you may or may not have that your immigration status, you know, as a student. It could be revoked. It could be. So it's a lot that can go on there.
Well, I do understand also that internationalization of higher education brings a lot of funding, brings a lot of investment, brings a lot of opportunity to the recipient countries. Mm-hmm. So, for instance, within our jurisdiction, the understanding is that a lot more Africans study elsewhere out of Africa. That means creating more jobs for those jurisdictions because we will pay fees, would engage in a number of issues that bring economic benefits to those countries or the destinations that we travel to. So it's a two-way thing. They make some level of money, we get knowledge to be able to come and impact our continent. Now, I'm beginning to look at it from this perspective. Mm-hmm. What does Africa need to do to attract students and faculty elsewhere to want to come to Africa to study or to lecture in our universities?
You know, this is a personal opinion, mm-hmm. but I believe it's an informed opinion. Africa, by many, is viewed as a country, not as a continent.
Okay.
So media images, what many Americans define or think of when you say Africa, is not the holistic Africa that I certainly know, that I've had truly the pleasure for over the 20-some years I've been traveling back and forth. And so a lot of it, I believe, is going to be good old-fashioned advertising, marketing, continuing to come to conferences that are hosted in the United States, so we know who is Africa. Because once I sit down and talk to students that come to my office on 101, and they ask me about my work in Africa, they all want to go to Africa. Mm-hmm. Many want to go to Africa. They want to do study abroads in Africa. They want to do cultural and experience programs in Africa. So you kind of peel back that curtain that you know, it's not just war, it's not just all the things and plague and all these unfortunate negative things that hit. So I think a more accurate lens to what Africa really is. I mean, the incredible research, the beauty of your culture, the traditions, the rituals, the tribal communities. I mean, those are lessons for the world, but then the story is told. Perhaps you've heard the TED Talk by one of your esteemed colleagues, young lady from Nigeria. It's called The Danger of the Single Story, and I encourage your viewers if they haven't watched that. And what she says is, if you only see Africa through a single story, you will never know Africa. And so that's a big passion of mine, is that trying to be the voice in my community of the real Africa, what I've seen.
Good. Now, a lot of times when the concept of internationalization in higher education is mentioned. Usually what comes into mind is students wanting to go study abroad. Much as that is good, I also think that faculty, lecturers, there is the need for African faculty to travel abroad, teach in European and American or universities of other jurisdictions, whilst others also come here, impart knowledge directly in African cities. I don't know what you
think. I also share with you that, matter of fact, in all of our memorandums of understandings that we have with some of the African universities, we have faculty exchange included as part of that general conversation, and we're waiting for that to happen. Concordia a couple of years ago was a pleasure to be able to host our first faculty from the University of Ghana as a Fulbright scholar that came over, and she was with us for a year. She not only taught classes, she really engaged with the students. She also, we gave her access to our executive council, because one of the things she wanted to learn was, how does your university run? You know, how is a very well-managed, very well-run university do this? And so she did. We included on everything, and she really just opened up the eyes of what about Africa, about Ghana. So yes, it is encouraged to be able to do that. So it's faculty exchange. In addition to that, Mr. Amwa, it's we look at curriculum exchanges. You know, I love to see what other universities or what other professors are teaching in their classrooms, books they're using, activities, exercises. I am more than willing and to share mine, I mean, if ever. And so it's just a matter of, we need to know each other. You know, we need to realize that it's not a vacuum. I don't teach in a vacuum, because my students don't hear me in a vacuum. And I hope, at least I hope I don't teach in a vacuum.
Okay. So basically you're encouraging faculty exchanges.
Absolutely.
Okay. So apart from the issue, you have told us about what Concordia is doing in line with that. And you have told us you had visitations from the University of Ghana. What are other universities across the world doing to facilitate faculty exchanges? I can tell you a bit about Africa.
Oh, good.
Okay. In Africa, the Association of African Universities, for instance, has what they call the Faculty Fellowship Academics to lecture in collaboration with the Economic Community of West African States, or the Swedish International Development Agency. So basically they get funding, then they send lecturers from one university in Africa to another university in Africa. So experiences can be felt, okay? So I'm thinking, beyond what the Association of African Universities is doing within the borders of Africa, how can this be extended? To the extent that you've given us one good example where the University of Ghana came to your university, can it be on a larger scale, so that when you meet an Asian lecturer and an African lecturer and somebody from another jurisdiction, your mindset about education, and for that matter higher education, may not differ so much because you've had some level of experiences in other in each other's jurisdictions. So apart from the given example that you gave, the MOU between you and the University of Ghana, what other strategies do exist for faculty to have a taste of internationalization?
What I know, and which is what I would like to share, is in addition to teaching exchanges, we would like to be able to do research exchanges on collaborative questions, collaborative areas that countries need information on. We haven't yet been able to do that at a larger level, but we've been able to do it more. We have a faculty that on a personal level, professional level, that's been able to do that. We have faculty that have conversations in Thailand and many in China, and here, you know, in Africa, we're looking at that. So it does exist, but it's right now today, as I'm aware of it, it's more on a personal individual level. But we are all out there. So, you know, we have, you know, 200 some faculty, roughly, you know, I think including kind of the different ranges, that all have their fingers in other places. So I hope more of that happens, and I hope when people are reaching out at the interpersonal level, they can say, okay, you know, I'm from Uganda, I'm from Brazil, you know, I'm from, you know, Togo, and I'm looking for how can we make gender better. Mentioning once again, and just being in Ethiopia, I was just walking across campus. It was giving us a detailed campus tour, and I met a young lady that I believe was from Sudan, and her area is gender. And she's saying it's getting much better. Now, as you know, in the U.S. politically, we have the Me Too movement that came out of some of the different areas. She wanted to, exchange information because she would like to be a part of a larger study on gender. And I said, not only do I do a little bit of that, but I have faculty at my university that's their area. So that exchange is going to happen. I return to the States on the 29th, and I am going to make sure I connect. So that could be that's a research piece where we both are faced with problems. We have challenges. And as one quote says, you know, like that, you're not going to find your answer necessarily where the problem was created. You have to look outside of that. So I don't know if that specifically answers your questions, but I know that in addition to teaching and research, now what from an administration capacity, what the professor from the University of Ghana shared with us, how does your university run? And she can take maybe some of our practices back to her. Now, what would be ideal is we have that same access at one of the universities in Ghana. And actually, Wisconsin University is actually where we're getting some really good insight. The founder of that university, Dr. Finn, has been phenomenal with being able to give us a window into how that university is run, and their vice chancellor, sort of international relations. We're on and they had to open up their doors to us, and they did so graciously, and we were so happy to do that.
No, fine. So I'll get back to you, but it's time for a break. Mm-hmm. And then when we return, we'll be talking a little more practical about your presence in Ghana in line with the same internationalization drive.
Thank you.
We will be back, viewers.
You may not have heard about us, but we have heard about you. You've been searching for a new kind of university that matches your ambition. Our world-class education is renowned. But there is more to us. Meet the university in Ghana that is transforming Africa. One that is nurturing a new generation of ethical, entrepreneurial leaders. One that offers scholarships thanks to the Mastercard Foundation, so that you can be part of our community of students who stand for integrity, discipline, and excellence. There is only one such university, only one, where 100% of graduates receive job offers or graduate school admissions. You may not have heard about us, but we have heard about you. You are Africa's future, and we are Ashesi University College. Together, we can begin to create a new Africa.
Thank you, viewers, for staying tuned to our program. I am here discussing with Professor Cheryl E. Williams of Concordia University, Ivan, United States of America. Prof, we did speak about internationalization and then implications for cultures and values across the world. Now, you told us in your previous discussion, mm-hmm, that you've been traveling across Africa for some period now. Mm-hmm. You cited Namibia before we went for the break. Now you are in Ghana. Why exactly are you here for?
Right. And thank you for letting me look this up on my phone. My memory is not always the best things. Mm-hmm. But thank you for asking. So Wisconsin International University has invited us to, myself and my provost, I'm traveling with Dr. Peter Sinkbile, our provost, and we're going to be part of a symposium this afternoon that I encourage anybody that's in the greater Ghana area to come and join us at the university. My specific topic is going to be responding to crisis, a communication guide on race, ethnicity, class, and gender in today's workplace and marketplace. So hopefully it's a very timely topic with a how-to connected to it, because as you know, one of the things communication specialists, and I was asked to address undergraduate students as my primary audience, on what skill set that industry is looking for and that is necessary. And that's just one of the skill sets that the strong communication professionals can do. My colleague, Dr. Peter Sinkbile, who is Concordia University Provost, is speaking on the economic benefits of the creative arts industry in the education sector. So we're hopefully brought out to there. We have another one of our colleagues that is a working professional. He's not a Concordia University faculty, or at least not yet, but his name is Mr. Ramsey J. Jr. And his topic will be leadership and the 21st century dynamic investment management framework. And Mr. J and Dr. Sinkbile and I had dinner last night. We're really just exchanging and collaborating how all three of our areas connect to making citizens of Ghana more wise, more honorable, more cultivated, more developed for what we're looking for in the world. So that, in addition, on Saturday, we have the pleasure is the Wisconsin, their graduation, their commencement. So Dr. Sinkbile will be delivering the keynote speech, the commencement address, and I'll be there in my regalia, congratulating and welcoming the graduates as well.
Well, so I think it is, what you are going to talk about would be important to our audience continentally through the AAU TV. I ask, whilst a number of employers, let me rather put it this way, whilst a number of graduates complain that there are no jobs for them, mm-hmm. employees or industry also complains that the graduates that we churn out of our universities lack the requisite skills,
exactly.
knowledge and attitude needed to meet the demands of industry. Mm-hmm. You would be speaking on skill sets for industry. Mm-hmm. What exactly should a graduate have to be able to meet the demands of industry? What are the skills?
Okay, thank you. And I feel fairly comfortable asking that, particularly from a more Western point of view, but I believe Ghana is westernized in many ways. I don't know if that's good or bad or indifferent, mm-hmm. but very much so, as well as other countries as well here. Industry today, corporate, are looking for graduates that can write, that can read, that can orally communicate, and that can critically think. Whether you're going into medicine, law, social sciences, literature, theater. And the millennials, as we now are calling this new generation, are so connected sometimes to technology, and this is a little bit of an opinion, because not all, certainly millennials, and not all of our younger graduates do this, but some of the things that I see when I'm doing interviewing, when I'm doing my classes, is a disconnect with critical thinking. It sometimes appears that they're almost looking for someone else to give them the answer. And I know I'm talking in pejoratives, I don't mean to stereotype, and please know that I'm certainly aware of that. But I see it overwhelmingly. Matter of fact, a nickname. It's not that I think I'm better than writing. How you do it is you write it. It doesn't come easy, as you know, as a professional yourself. As well as, you know, oral communication. Some people, you know, allow communication anxiety, which is probably what I have now, but to stifle them. But that's learned. These are all learned skills. Now, granted, people have different passions in doing that. One way, Mr. Amwa, to do that is most campuses have something around what they call career services.
Okay.
Maybe name different. I know on our campus is the career services.
Okay.
And we have a full-time person at the director level, so she's at the management level, whose primary job is to liaise between our graduating or our students for internships even and the communities. And by the communities, it's businesses, it's profits, for-profit organizations, non-profit organizations, to be able to see what is your entry-level requirements, as well as, you know, some of our students, particularly our MBA students, that may already be fully employed but looking for better, you know, jobs or careers, the reason why they may have done that. She also works with for when you're looking for areas that's not just entry-level jobs. And it's not just for the U.S. So she also looks for what's available overseas and international, because as we look for students, you know, we look for your graduates, you know, many organizations, many companies in the U.S. would hire African graduates in a heartbeat if they could do if they bring the skill set to complete the job. Look, the business person just wants to get the job done. They want to do it legally. They don't want to do it ethically. They want to do it ethically, and they want to do it fast. So you come in with writing skill. You come in with speaking skill. You come in with critical thinking skill. Many businesses can train you on the specifics of what may be happening at that spot, but that you have to come in with that type of personal development.
Well, I do think that almost all of the topics you would be discussing today at Wisconsin International University seem to be thematic areas that are resonating with Africa today.
Oh, good.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Next week in Nigeria, Africa would be meeting at the Olusegun Obasanjo Presidential Center to discuss economic benefits of the creative arts industry.
Nice.
And much as I know you are not going to be speaking on this, what do you think are some of the benefits of Africa's creative arts industry?
You know, the creative arts industry, in many times, is what people pay attention to.
Okay.
And as you heard me mention earlier, you know, Africa needs, and I'm speaking of it as a continent, needs to let their story be told accurately through the lens of the African, through the lens of, and if it is someone that's coming over from a different country, they go back and they tell an accurate story. They show accurate visuals. And we do that through song, through theater, through television, through entertainment. I mean, that's a pop culture. That's a popular cultural area that is what people pay attention to. Look, if you can have the best information in the world to share, but if no one pays attention to it, then it's for naught. So our creative arts industry really helps fill in that vacuum for people paying attention. And then from there, they say, oh, I think I want to go do that. I want to go try that. And so that's one of the things that I believe, if you like that. And Dr. Sinkbile will be doing a phenomenal job this afternoon talking just about that and connecting that. So we understand how can the creative arts industry be part of your economic win, if I can say.
Okay. You did say Ramsey J would also be talking about leader. Am I correct?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
In the context of internationalization of higher education, what do African leaders have to do?
Well, from what I understand, Mr. J will be talking about, and Mr. J, in addition to being a financial guru and a young gentleman, he also is a motivational speaker. Mm-hmm. And what I mean by that is he really gives you a life skills and a life plan. Okay. He's going to help say, here's to get you from step one to step two to step three, and included with the financial piece and how we think. Because oftentimes, and I can speak from the African-American in my community, and once again, I don't mean to stereotype and say it's all, it's that, you know, we're very, we buy material things, you know, we don't think of saving, we don't think of wealth management, because, you know, sometimes you're just trying to pay the bills and keep food on the table or that. But, you know, we have to get a mindset that it's more than that. So I think not only the African nation, but the world, you know, like this, and needs to be able to start thinking of that. And he's going to be able to give a blueprint. So regardless of what or where someone's financial state might be today, what can you do? And that's I believe it's going to be. I'm looking forward to hearing him.
Well, I think you have delved into the topic much more than I expected.
Oh,
yes,
you.
And I should say that you've been a good ambassador of your university,
Thank
Concordia.
You.
I don't know if you have some last words for our viewers.
You know, once again, have your passion. There's an old saying a Chinese saying that is, if you really love what you do, you won't work a day in your life. And what it means by that, you know, is whatever is dear to you. So I would encourage someone, which is what I tell my own two sons, and they're now doing this, is don't just look for the degree or the area that's the highest paid. Because one day you might find yourself in what I call golden handcuffs. So you find yourself making the money, but you're miserable. You're coming to work every day, and you're miserable. So find that passion, stick to it, and it'll ring true. It'll be true. It'll make for a great life. I love what I do. I've been doing it for almost 40 years, and I love it every day. I love it as much today as I did many years ago. So thank you for having
me. Thank you, Prof, for coming through. Viewers, have been speaking with Professor Cheryl Williams of the Concordia University, Ivan, United States of America. Would come your way within the course of the week with another edition of AAU Talk. I have been Fred Awa, your host. Thank you.
Your health while working from home. A sedentary lifestyle is detrimental to one's health and increases the risk of obesity, diabetes, hypertension, and heart diseases. For a healthy heart, one must have a more holistic approach and work on lifestyle correction. Increase physical activity, reduce stress, sleep soundly, along with a healthy, balanced diet. In such situations where you are working from home, while in this era of a global pandemic, it is easy to indulge in foods that might taste good, but can harm our heart's health in the longer run and will even lead you to gain unhealthy weight. But you should know that a healthy heart leads to a long and healthy life. Keeping this mantra in mind, we should include a healthy diet and a good workout routine as part of our lifestyle. Take a look at some routines that you can do from home without gym equipment, but still as effective. These routines and more to ensure that your health is still in its best state. Yoga cannot be left out when it comes to relaxation, physical activity, and generally keeping a balanced state of mind and body. Yoga helps you to relax but still stay healthy. Take a look at some yoga routines that help in relaxation, among others. Nutritionists around the world believe that while 30% of good health comes from a regular and effective exercise routine, diet plays an important role in managing the other 70%. Keeping this in mind, let us check out some diet tips that can not only give us a healthy body but also a strong heart. Cut down on fatty foods. Besides cutting down fried, fatty, processed, packaged, oily, and spicy foods, one needs to incorporate in moderation healthy fats like olive oil, coconut oil, and mustard oil, in addition to avocado and a variety of nuts and seeds. Omega-3 is one of the most healthy fats to include in our diet.
along with slowing down the risk of irregular heartbeats. These also slow down the buildup of plaque in our arteries. Diet should be rich in omega-3 fatty foods like fatty fish, walnuts, and flax seeds. 2. Cut down on refined grains. Refined grains such as all-purpose flour or white rice are low on fiber and may lead to an increase in bad cholesterol. To reduce the damage caused by refined grains and to build a healthy heart, you can consume complex carbohydrates, adding a large variety of whole grains, beans, legumes, fruits, and vegetables, which makes a diet rich in fiber, helping to reduce the risk of heart disease. 3. Consume more green leafy vegetables. The most famous leafy greens, such as spinach and lettuce, are rich sources of vitamin K, which makes sure to keep your arteries are blood clot free. These are also rich in other essential minerals that manage blood pressure. Finally, cut down on processed foods. Processed foods have preservatives in them and they can cause damage to our heart's health. Instead of that, try to cook as much food at home as possible as you can. Nothing beats homemade food anyway. Drink enough water throughout the day. Avoid consumption of fizzy drinks. Sound sleep also helps in reducing the stress hormones in the body. This is all for today on your favorite health show, Health Afrik. I am Bridget Amadente.
The Association of African Universities, AAU, is an international non-governmental organization set up by universities in Africa to promote cooperation among themselves and the international academic community.
Mon nom est Professeur Étienne Ewan Eile. Je suis le secrétaire général de l'Association des universités africaines qui est basée à Accra, au Ghana. Je vais vous parler de la création de l'Association des universités africaine. Il faut remonter dans les années 60 pour pouvoir comprendre le processus. Déjà en 1960, nos dirigeants estimaient que l'éducation est l'outil majeur pour pouvoir lutter contre la pauvreté et assurer le développement.
I am not Tumo Dlamini. I'm the Director of ICT Services and Knowledge Management at the Association of African Universities. The Association of African Universities is a network of 400 universities in Africa. The biggest value that the universities benefit from being members of the association is this big platform that allows them to collaborate, allows them to work together, allows them to teach together. Through this platform, a university in North Africa can work with a university in Southern Africa, and also those in East Africa can work with those in West Africa.
Founded November 1967 at a conference in Rabat, Morocco, by heads of African higher education institutions, the association is currently headquartered in Accra, Ghana.
My name is Maxwell Amohoit. I'm the Director of Finance of the Association of African Universities. The association sustains itself from contributions from member universities and also from other development partners. Some of our development partners include the World Bank, other governmental agencies like the Swedish International Development Agency, UK Department for International Development, and other partners. We also receive a lot of support from other governments, especially the government of Ghana. Other partners include the African Union, which is more or less the parent organization of the Association of African Universities. The Association of African Universities hosts the Secretariat for the African Union's continental education strategy. And by so doing, we provide coordinating roles for the African Union in helping members achieve their targets.
Déjà en 1960, nos dirigeants estimaient que l'éducation est l'outil majeur pour pouvoir lutter contre la pauvreté et assurer le développement. Et rappelons-nous que les années 60, la décade 60, a été une décade où la plupart des pays africains ont obtenu leur indépendance ou ont, disons, pris les dispositions pour être indépendants. C'était donc aussi l'année de développement, dans la mesure où tous ces pays indépendants devaient se retrouver de temps en temps pour parler de comment mettre ensemble leurs problèmes et trouver une solution commune à leurs problèmes. Et dans ce contexte-là, l'éducation était une priorité pour eux. Surtout l'éducation universitaire. Et sur ce plan-là, les universités aussi se sont organisées grâce à l'UNESCO qui a parrainé plusieurs réunions depuis Madagascar jusqu'au Maroc.
My name is Jonathan Umba. I'm the Director of Research and Academic Planning. The programs and projects that we run at AAU are consistent with our strategic plan, and they are implemented for our higher education stakeholders, namely the higher education institutions in Africa. These programs are implemented in such a way that our stakeholders will get the benefit of membership of our association. And our programs also are aligned with a number of global and international agendas on higher education, including the Continental Education Strategy for Africa and Agenda 2063. So these programs are aligned with a number of international agendas with a view to promoting higher education in Africa.
The AAU is the apex organization and principal forum for consultation, exchange of information, and cooperation among universities in Africa.
I am Professor Nkrumah Mahau, Vice Chancellor of the National University of Lesotho in the Kingdom of Lesotho in Southern Africa. There are roughly 77 universities that are affiliated with the AAU in the region. But as you might be aware, there are a lot more universities that are as yet to take the membership of the Association of African Universities. Well, universities that are not members of the AAU are missing quite a lot. First of all, let's appreciate this one point, that the AAU is a main driver from the angle of training and capacitating the human resources of the continent, the agenda of the African Union 2063. So if an institution is not on board, it is missing the opportunity to leverage on the opportunities that are provided by the association in the area of training human resource capital, training their own staff and students, the opportunities that are provided by the universalization of quality management on higher education on the continent, and many other opportunities that are provided.
Et en 1963, il y a eu une réunion à Khartoum, au Soudan, où les chefs des institutions d'enseignement supérieur ont décidé de créer l'Association des universités africaines. Finalement, la création va se faire à une conférence qui s'est tenue à Rabat au Maroc, Et la création de l'Association des universités africaines a eu lieu le 12 novembre 1967.
I'm Prof. Hassan Kafi, AAU governing board member, representing for East African region. Also, I am the president of Plasma University, Mogadishu, Somalia. We really like to give a call for universities in Africa, especially in East Africa, those which are not members still in the Association of African Universities. We are calling them because we feel the organization is ours. It represents the voice of higher education in Africa being seen all over the world.
Africa, you're welcome to AgriLink on AAU TV. AgriLink is a program that aims at showcasing and highlights agricultural activities.